it's frustrating, man, when it's like that.
So as you were starting to, like, you know, get involved with all these different artists and these places, who are some of the people that influenced you, aside from Quincy, to really just keep, you know, moving forward?
P-Rock. P-Rock. Eric Turman. Large Professor, Q-Tip.
Large Professor's my, one of my favorites.
Yeah, Premier. Jay Dilla. Like, I got some sick ones. Just Self-Service, I was watching him because we both from Queens, and he was doing all the shit from DMX and all the shit from Murder, Inc. and everything. So I was watching him too, you know what I'm saying? It's just like, yo, I got to get it right. I got to get just as hot as my man right here, you know what I'm saying? I got to be just as good, you know what I'm saying?
So how did the whole situation come about with the Moulin Rouge? Because you've always been known, for the most part, to be a hip-hop type producer. Now, this record came out of the blue. I think that was probably, like, it got more of, like, the mainstream really know who you were as a producer. How did that whole thing come about?
Lady Marmalade was a situation that Missy, it was Missy's job. And I remember her calling me in the room, and she was just like, you know, there's this project that they want me to do for a movie. And she said it was, the song was Lady Marmalade, they want me to do that over. And she was like, a lot of people backed away from it, would you be down to do it? So I'm sitting there like, damn, I hate that song. You know what I'm saying? I hate minor chords. I hate, and I think Lady Marmalade is in a minor, right? I used to like happy major chords, you know what I'm saying? So when I heard that, I was just like, dang, man, I don't want to do shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, but then like, I said, okay, well, if you lock me in a studio for 24 hours, I get it done, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, because if it's your project, I know something's about to happen from it, so I ain't gonna be
so. It's a big paper check.
So I asked her, I said, would you put me in the studio, give me every keyboard I want? They said, yeah, so I ordered a TR Rack chord, I ordered the JV 5080, a JV with all the cards in it, Asia, techno, everything. So I was actually in a room with all the equipment that I wanted. So I was like, all right, had me some soup, you know what I'm saying, and just stitched it. Like, I was like listening to it, like stitching and stitching and stitching it. And when I was finished, I called Missy in the room, and she was just like, yo, this is crazy. But the thing was, is when you saw the girls walk in the room, then that's when you know it's serious business. So I was sitting back looking like, okay, we just did a hot track. And then I saw Christina coming. I said, "What the fuck is that?" I saw Pink. I was like, "All right, Maya, then Little Kim, and you know what I'm saying." And then the guy from the movie, and then Jimmy IV walked in. When he walked in, I was like, "Oh shit!"
The money just starts speaking up the place.
And he's like, "Hey, guy, how you doing?" And I'm like, "What the?" What?
Don't touch me.
No, don't touch me to hell.
No, you can touch me. Like, trust me.
I was like, and you know, and that's when it got serious. And as I start seeing it come together, then Ron Fair, one of the best producers, I'm telling you, like, if this dude ever gets on any of your tracks, you will see magic happen, because he just called piano players in. Like, there was a lot of stuff that I did that when I saw the band do it over, like bringing it up, I was just like, oh shit, like, this is production right here, you know? Because hip hop is just all you, but when you just see everybody come in, like, there's a lot of musicians and producers that participated on that song, and then Missy came up in there and put her magic to it, and Ron Fair came in there and just stitched it. Like, a lot of people don't understand that there was keyboards with people's vocals on the keyboards. So there was a Lil Kim keyboard, there was a Pink keyboard, there was a Christina Aguilera keyboard, and they each had ad-libs. So like, a lot of those ad-libs that's in that record are pressed, like, because they did so many takes of ad-libs. And this is the first time I've ever been in a studio. I ain't talking your head off, man. I ain't talking your head off.
You're done.
But I'll go. But what I'm saying is, like, they did so many takes of ad-libs that I would have been like, all right, that's a good ad-lib. You know what I'm saying? And they were like, nah, she got to do it again. And I was like, that's Christina Aguilera. She can't do no damn better than that. He was like, nah, just keep on. So then I came in there one day, and it was just a whole bunch of tape of just ad-libs and said, Christina Aguilera, ad-lib one. Christina Aguilera, good one. Christina Aguilera, might use. Because it was like a whole bunch of those. And I'm just sitting there like, wow, like, what goes into production? producing that I thought I had already accomplished, they let me know that I'm still like, what?
I'm sitting up there. I doubt that. But
yeah, musicians is around me like, turn around, and dudes is playing drums with no shoes, and I'm just like, oh, damn, like, shit, it's a rock. Where you going? I'm going to lounge and watching TV, boy. I think y'all pretty much got this under control, and I don't need me in there no more, you know?
So what is a record like that, I mean, just to kind of give these guys something of perspective, what is a record like that and the accomplishment behind it do for a producer's career? Like, what did it really do for you to help you get to where you are now?
It was the Grammy of the vocal collabo thing was big. And the fact that when you win a Grammy, it's like when you do a song like that and you win a Grammy, it's like you're here for good. It's like, we don't have to do another damn track again when you do something like that. Like, and then I bought my house off Lady Marmalade. Like, I wasn't even supposed to buy a certain house, and this lady was like, well, what do you do? And I was like, well, I don't know, I do music. And she's like, well, what songs, you know, have you done? I might know. And I'm looking at her like, you know. Then I'm like, I did Lady Marmalade. And she's like, wow, that's like my favorite song. I work out to that every day. And she gave me the house. Like for real. Like for real. And the neighbor, in that neighborhood, you were supposed to be a family. Like, you, I'm walking up in there like this one black dude in this big neighborhood. And they're just like, what do you do? And I'm like, well, you know, because I wasn't supposed to go with the people to buy the house, because the realtor was going there with a man already, so it was looking like they were the couple buying the house. So when I finally went there, she was like, what do you do? I told her I produced, and I said, Lady Marmalade. And she said, I work out to that every morning, and everything went through. Like, everything. Closing, everything went through. So it has its benefits, you know what I'm saying? You know. and also, it was just an amazing song, you know. You know, I feel good when I hear it, you know, because it was something that I definitely didn't know that I was going to accomplish when I was doing it, you know. So God is good on that.
So you've had a very interesting career, to say. Weird, interesting. What are some of your most proud moments or accolades, or just things that you said, wow, like, I really can't believe I did that, and I really, you know, I really appreciate the fact that I did something like that?
I would say that, the Lady Marmalade song. And when I started doing stuff like for wrestling and all that type of stuff, and, you know, started doing like commercials and stuff like that, like, that's when I was really like, wow, I can't believe, like, I'm seeing my music come back at me. Like, sometimes I wake up and I just go through all my songs I've done, just every song, and I just be sitting back like, wow, like, you know, I used to look in the crate at records, and now I'm in that crate, because that's all I want. I only wanted one song, y'all. I didn't want a whole bunch of records. I only wanted one song with my name on it. Just to say, yo, I got that song. You know what I'm saying? In the street, you'd be like, yo, I got a record. But, you know, like, it was a very blessed career. You know what I'm saying? I guess I still got more to do. I don't feel like I still done anything. You know what I'm saying? I feel like I got more.
That's what I was going to ask you next. Like, what, how do you measure your success? Like, what keeps you motivated to keep moving forward?
My family. You know what I'm saying? My friends. You know what I'm saying? I got great friends. You know what I'm saying? And, God, of course, you know what I'm saying? I don't move without God, you know what I'm saying? The angels is the music, that's what I call it. A lot of the stuff that I do, I do, it's a lot of angels in the room, but like, you know, that's what it is. My little girl, my little son, you know what I'm saying? Like, my family, that's what really gets it. Cause that's what I'm thinking about when I'm doing a track, you know what I'm saying?
Come on, dance for me a rock.
You sounded like God to me.